Thank you so much for joining us for CBN Newswatch. I'm Ephraim Graham. Ahead today, the White House mounts a plan to tackle high gas prices. We'll bring you all the details. Plus, a driver plows his SUV into a Christmas parade.
We are hurting. We are angry. We are sad. We are Waukesha strong.
See what we've learned about the circumstances leading up to the event. And a booster for the holidays.
We are seeing more breakthrough infections.
The latest concern for health experts. Plus, God gives us free will. Why a woman says she chose to come back to Earth after seeing heaven.
But in a blink of an eye, I smelt the flowers. I heard the singing. I opened my eyes. I knew that I was in heaven.
All this and more are ahead next.
This is CBN Newswatch.
We begin this half hour with developments in the Wisconsin parade investigation. An SUV charged into the crowd, killing five and injuring nearly 50. 18 of those were children. The driver of the SUV is in custody, facing five intentional homicide charges, and is set to appear in court today. CBN's Jenna Browder has more.
The community of Waukesha, Wisconsin is mourning the loss of fellow citizens, family, and friends. Last night, gathering for a prayer vigil not far from the scene of the tragedy. Five dead, at least 48 injured, including 18 children, some still fighting for their lives.
There was just like so many like bodies in the road. And then I saw them like start to pick them up, and they were like little kids.
I literally saw roughly 10 people bounce off that car, and you could hear thud, 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 thud as he drove through that.
Part of the chaos was captured on the city's live stream of the parade and various cell phone videos, one showing a child dancing in the street as the SUV speeds by. And we're learning more about the victims. Three of those killed were part of the Milwaukee Dancing Grannies, a marching and dancing group of grandmothers that's been around for nearly 40 years. Brian Wallace says he was with one of them in her final moments.
She died in my arms.
The community still reeling.
We are hurting. We are angry. We are sad. We are Waukesha strong.
39-year-old Daryl Brooks is in custody, facing five counts of first-degree intentional homicide. Police say Brooks had just left the scene of a domestic dispute but was not being pursued. And he has a long rap sheet, charged with 16 crimes since 1999. Earlier this month, he was accused of running over the mother of his child. And that's raising questions and a renewed call to give judges more power to set higher bails. Republicans calling it an example of a broken legal system. If convicted, Brooks could face life in prison. Jenna Browder, CBN News.
The White House is looking to combat high gas prices by ordering 50 million barrels of oil from the Strategic Petroleum Reserve. Right now, gas prices are averaging about $3.40 a gallon, more than double their price from just a year ago. The reserve is supposed to be used only for disruptions like natural disasters, and the move still may not have a major impact on gas prices. Here now, some other stories are following for you in the CBN newsroom. A tourist bus carrying people home crashed and caught fire in western Bulgaria this morning. At least 45 people died. Children are among the victims. Investigators believe the bus hit a highway guardrail, crashed, and caught fire. An investigation is underway. Today, the prosecution made its final rebuttal in closing arguments in the Ahmaud Arbery trial for his murder. It is now in the hands of the jury as deliberation begins. You can get complete coverage later on Faith Nation here on the CBN News Channel. The demand for booster shots is on the rise as Americans prepare to gather with friends and family this holiday season. 70% of Americans say they plan to spend the holiday with family and friends from outside their home. Friday, the Centers for Disease Control gave the green light for boosters for all adults of Pfizer and Moderna vaccines 6 months after their second dose. But health officials are still concerned about getting the unvaccinated vaccinated, especially with the recent surge.
We are seeing more breakthrough infections. That is expected to increase in the coming months because of the winter weather.
34 states right now are seeing a surge in new infections. Lots of people are looking to fly to and from their destination for the holiday season. The TSA expects the Sunday after Thanksgiving to be the busiest travel day of the year with an estimated 2.4 million passengers. Here's some tips to help you save. First, don't wait until the day of your flight to see if your trip is scheduled correctly. If your flight gets canceled or significantly delayed, you are entitled to a cash refund under federal law, but check to see if you could also negotiate for a different trip. And finally, get to the airport early and pack your patience. If you're looking to drive a vehicle to your destination, here are some tips to save you. Slow down and drive the speed limit. Avoid those hard accelerations. When approaching lights or stop signs, take your foot off the gas early to allow your car to reach a slower speed before stopping. Also, use cruise control to maintain a consistent speed. Much of America is on edge these days, and one of the biggest flashpoints is the issue of racism. Many Christian leaders say if we're ever truly going to be one nation under God, the solution starts with God's Word and His people. CBN's Tara Mergener reports on a new nationwide movement toward biblical unity.
Take one look across the social media landscape and you get the feeling this is the divided states of America rather than the United States. Christian leaders say it is time for change, and what better place to begin than the Bible? Inside the nation's only museum dedicated to the Word of God, the Sounds of Praise. Prayer and fellowship kick off a timely conversation.
Tonight, we are going to step on the third rail. We're going to talk about race and religion.
Men and women from churches across the country ready to talk about the sin of racism, even among fellow Christians, and how it contradicts the biblical principle of Imago Dei, that all people are created in God's image.
I just want to be able today to share my story.
Speakers shared their own stories of pain, trauma, and healing.
I am very excited to be here because for the first time I might say some things that I was afraid to say in the past.
No matter what has happened in your life, no matter how much trauma you have experienced, please don't give up.
This event marks the beginning of a national campaign called Let's Talk, bringing together Christian leaders and ministries, including CBN. Campaign founder Dr. Derek Greer says scripture shows the solution to racial division.
The children of Israel were under great stress and strain. The nation was in trouble. And the Bible says, then those who fear the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord heard. And the goal today is to simply follow biblical principles and talk to one another.
No justice!
No peace!
With continued calls for criminal justice reform and courtroom cases charged with racial overtones, dialogue is ever more crucial in helping pastors and their congregations navigate a path toward healing, forgiveness, and reconciliation.
Church is not supposed to be one people group, but we now have a responsibility and a mantle on us as leaders in God's church to show the world what heaven looks like. And if we can't do it in the church, how can we expect the world to do it the right way?
These conversations will continue with monthly Zoom calls to help churches gain understanding and practical solutions. The goal is adding more voices while modeling the biblical principle of Christians, regardless of color or background, while living together in unity. Tara Mergener for CBN News.
Coming up, eyes on a Hollywood A-lister and thoughts of him entering politics, from speculation to what if and what was polled in a hypothetical. We'll have more next. Welcome back to CBN News Watch. If Matthew McConaughey ran for Texas governor, he might just win. That is according to a recent poll about a hypothetical run by the actor. Here now with more is FaithWire's Billy Hallowell. So, Billy, to be clear, McConaughey has not said he is running for governor, but he has mentioned it.
He has mentioned it. He has said earlier this year that he'd be a fool not to consider it, but he has not committed to it. There is no indication that he will definitely do it. And let's remember, he was promoting a book at the time, right? So he was out there promoting his book and talking and saying, look, you know, I have to consider this. I have no idea if I'll do it. I'd be a fool not to.
Now, tell us about this hypothetical poll by the University of Texas and the Dallas Morning News.
This is a fascinating poll because they've done a number of them, but this was the first one where you had Beto O'Rourke in the mix too. And what essentially happened in this poll, and this is of 1,100 voters out in Texas, registered voters, it was basically found that both candidates, both the current sitting governor, Greg Abbott, and Beto O'Rourke would lose to Matthew McConaughey if an election were held today. And the numbers are really fascinating. It's 43% choosing Matthew McConaughey in a hypothetical head-to-head with Greg Abbott, and 35% choosing the governor. And it was an even wider range. Matthew McConaughey gets 49% up against Beto, and Beto only gets 27% in that hypothetical. That's pretty noteworthy.
Indeed it is. So the public is really interested in seeing him run. He has commented on the poll. And has he commented on the poll, I want to say?
He has not commented on the poll yet. One of the interesting things, too, is that 40% of the public, when you ask them, do you want to see him run in Texas, 4 out of 10 Texans say yes, and 33% say no. And then there's a wide swath of people, you know, 20% plus who aren't sure, who don't really care. But 40%, that's, again, it's a pretty stunning statistic.
Any bets here?
You know, I'm guessing he doesn't run. But then again, look, former President Donald Trump, nobody thought he would run for years. He ran. You go back to Ronald Reagan. There's a long history here of people in Hollywood who move over into politics, and also a public that is very exhausted from politics looking for other options. So my bet is he doesn't run. But I do think there's definite intrigue, and I understand why.
Indeed. Thank you so much. I want to remind you that, of course, you can catch more at faithwire.com. Thank you for bringing us this. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Still ahead, a woman died and went to heaven. The beautiful sight she describes. But why did she choose to come back to Earth? We've got the answer for you when we come back. Stay with us. A woman says she died and went to heaven. Now she's back on Earth sharing with others the beautiful things she saw. Charlene Aaron and Wendy Griffith spoke with Charlotte Holmes on the Prayer Link.
Well, the last time you were with us, Charlotte, you shared about what happened to you when your heart stopped while you were in the hospital last year. And for those who may have missed that interview, tell us what happened to you.
I had been hooked up. My blood pressure was extremely high. My heart doctor put me in the hospital. Blood pressure was 234 over 134. All of a sudden, they had come in and given me a little sponge bath and was hooking me up to the monitors. My husband told me that I all of a sudden fell over in bed. My eyes were wide open. Within a short time frame, I come above my body. And I looked down and I could see my husband. I could see the doctors, the nurses. I could see him doing chest compressions on me. And for 11 minutes, I didn't breathe. But in a blink of an eye, I smelt the flowers. I heard the singing. I opened my eyes. I knew that I was in heaven. I seen angels.
You knew that you were in heaven. How did you know? Tell us, what did you see? Tell us, you know, tell us more about, you know, the colors and what you smelled.
The first thing was I smelled flowers. Now, I love flowers, but these were like no flowers that is on this earth, the smell. And then I heard music, and I love music, but there is no music like the angels and people praising God. When I opened my eyes, the beauty was indescribable. The colors were vibrant, the trees, the grass, the flowers, the oceans, everything was wonderful. And the sky even, I've never seen the northern lights, but I've seen them on TV. And that's exactly what it was. And then I seen angels. In a short period of time, because it's eternity in heaven, there's no time frame. God let me just visually see so much. And then I turned and I looked, and when I did, I see the golden gates. I seen them. They were gold. I seen a streets of gold. I see my family.
Charlotte, you mentioned that you saw friends and family who had passed away, you know, years before, including a baby that you had miscarried, you know, years before. And a lot of people are really interested to hear about that. Tell us more about that.
As I looked upon my mother and my dad and my sister and family, I seen this infant at my mom and dad's feet. Danny and I had a daughter, and then she was about almost 2 years old. Well, I was pregnant again, and I miscarried at 5.5 months. Well, back then, they didn't let you hold your baby. They didn't let you bury your baby. So there was this baby that's this big, and they said, Charlotte, it's a boy. Well, I went through depression. If people don't believe in depression, then I'm glad you don't, because you've never been through it then. But I wanted that baby. So as I looked upon this infant at my mom and dad's feet, I couldn't understand who that was. I knew everybody else, because it says in the Bible, we will be known as we were known. But I couldn't realize who that was. And God just told me, said, that's your child. Mm-hmm. And I said, but how? Mm. How can my child I was 5.5 months be now a toddler? And he explained that they continue to grow in heaven, but there's no time, so it's eternity. So 40 some years later, my child, our child, was a toddler.
Wow, I can't imagine how you felt.
That's amazing.
Well, at one point, Charlotte, you looked back at your husband and family on earth, and they were crying. God gave you the choice to stay or return to earth. Why did you decide to return?
At that moment, when I looked back, I could see them crying. I have a granddaughter that's 20, a grandson that's 22. And I thought, I just want to see them get married. I want to be sure they're equally yoked. I want to be sure that my granddaughter has a husband that will lay his hands on her and pray for her, help her through this life. And the same with my grandson. And maybe I think it's a mother's instinct. And people said, why would you do that? And I said, I really can't answer that. But you see, I think my life had already been ordained from the day I was born, because I almost died the day I was born. Mm. And due to the things and circumstances that went through my life, I think it was already ordained. God knew. He knew when he gave me a choice that I was going to go back. He knew that I couldn't quit talking about it, that I had to share what he chose.
For more on this, you can catch the prayer link on CBN News Channel or at the CBN News app. On the CBN News Channel, it begins at 6:30 Eastern Standard Time this evening. Coming up, the latest movie about the life of beloved Christian author C.S. Lewis continues on the big screen. We'll give you the story behind the extension when we come back. C.S. Lewis went from atheist to the most beloved Christian writer of the century. It's also the subject of the film The Most Reluctant Convert. By popular demand, its run has been extended, and the film's star, Max McLean, is with us in Studio 5.
There's one story that's not so well known. It's my story. And who better to tell it than me?
So, Max, what is it about C.S. Lewis that's drawn you to this character?
I've been living with Lewis for, 45 years, I think.
Cheers.
I'm an adult convert to Christianity. And Lewis captured my imagination immediately.
I love the smell of bunting.
And I was undone.
Lewis has been a bottomless well of nourishment and spiritual guidance ever since.
How could a mere man be called a great moral teacher and say the sort of things Jesus said?
Such as?
What is it about the most reluctant convert that has captured people's attention so much so its run has been extended?
I think people are really interested in Christianity or in spirituality at a very serious level, but they don't know how to talk about it. And so Lewis allows them to think deeply about it. I mean, he was born into the faith, and then he had some terrible experiences growing up. He came to the conclusion that either there's no God behind the universe, a God who's indifferent to good and evil, or worse, an evil God.
Either there's no God behind the universe, a God indifferent to good and evil, or worse, an evil God.
So he was, you know, he was in a paradoxical position. And I think a lot of people are exploring those very same questions.
Do you believe that logic and reason bring forth indisputable truth?
I do. But beyond that, he realized that he was accountable to God in a very deep way, the God who created him.
Do you see Max in CS since you've lived with CS so long?
I see, I think it might be a little bit more CS in Max.
Ah.
You know, he's really shown me the importance of the intellect, but not the intellect alone, but really integrated with the spirit and the emotion.
For the first time, I examined myself with a serious, practical purpose.
How do you think he would feel about the celebration of the work that he left behind?
I do hope that people that love him see a lot of him in our movie. He's become a wonderful spiritual guide, not just to me, but to millions of people. And I do think that's one of the reasons why the film resonates so much.
That night, as I read Fantastis, my imagination was baptized. The rest of me took a little longer.
The movie is doing so well at the box office, it's been extended now through November 25th. You can go to cslewismovie.com to see locations and times in your area. Time now for your Tuesday Tweetable. I pray this message will bless you and you will bless others by posting, tagging, tweeting, and sharing with those in your circle. There is no change in your comfort zone. It's time to get comfortable being uncomfortable. That is the only place to find true success. With that word, I encourage you to make today a terrific Tuesday and be sure to have yourself a wonderful rest of the week. That is going to do it for this edition of CBN Newswatch. I want to remind you, you can always find more of our programs on the CBN News channel at any time. You can also find them online at cbnnews.com. We'd love to know what you think about the stories you've seen here today. You can email us. The address is right there at the bottom of your screen, newswatch@cbn.com. You can also reach out and touch us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Hope you'll join us again right back here, same time tomorrow. We'll see you here. Thanks for watching, everybody.